Amen. Welcome to church. Hallelujah. Stand and let's worship this morning.
I sing glory to His name. Good morning, good morning. Happy BGMC. I can't believe this is already our second one of the year. Maggie, you're supposed to stand up here with me. I'm going to take a second just to talk about our family Sunday next Sunday, which is going to be our first one of the year, if you don't mind. Thank you, ma'am. So our theme is going to be pack the pew in your tennis shoes and bring your whole family too. So bust out your Skechers and come on. Pastor is going to center his message around like the family as a whole, and you don't want to miss it. And I'm really excited to see how the kids are going to act in big church, and what all they're going to learn just by watching y'all and how you. It's okay. She's like, when I brought this idea to Pastor at the beginning of the year, I kind of approached him just really hating that the kids don't really get to experience church like I did personally when I was growing up. I told him that I really learned the basics of church and how to be a church kid, per se, you know, just by watching and listening to everybody else around me, you know. I'll be quite honest with you, Pastor, wherever you're at. Okay. You know, I can't really tell you much that I learned, you know, from the preaching as much as I learned, you know. As much as I learned just that being in the atmosphere, you know, around everybody else. You do a great job. You're just do amazing. You know. Why I turned out so good, you know. Right. You know, I learned how to raise my hands by watching my mom and dad worship next to me, and I learned that you learned what the altar was by coming down here and passing out tissues to all the old people crying, you know. And I learned what the gift of interpretation was by listening to Brother Jack Howell every Sunday, and I learned that I know we love Brother Jack. I learned a really hard lesson about speaking in tongues. Me and my sister actually learned it. It was a tough one. We would laugh at people speaking in tongues every Sunday under the church pews, and my mom would beat us. That was probably controversial. She would tear us up every Sunday in the bathroom, and we learned that it really wasn't funny. It wasn't funny anymore after a while.
Turning into more than what I thought it was going to be.
I was thinking about this morning. I learned how much you really miss your church family whenever they're gone because nobody stepped up in the Candyman's shoes.
Right.
I don't remember what his name was.
Bill Mason.
Nobody stepped into his shoes after he passed away. And I'm going to volunteer Harry Sneeds for that one. He doesn't know it yet. But he's going to be it. But I grew up crawling under the pews you're sitting in, and, you know, you just learn some really good church etiquette just by watching all the people around you, you know. You just don't know what you're missing until you get in here and you get to watch them act crazy. But there's a lot to learn from your parents, and I'm excited to see what all you get from it. I'll have goodie bags for the kids. I'll get them entertained. Don't worry about it, but if they got to get up and go to the bathroom and get water 5 times, we'll adjust. Let them be little. At least they're little here, right, being in church. Right. So, yeah. So, we got Maggie and we got her older sister, Miss Rayleigh. They're going to sing us a special this morning, but I really hope to see y'all. If it's packed in here, I'll give up my chair. So, it'll be good. I hope to see. I mean, I guess. So, yeah. Have on. You get the rest of the service. You get up here and you can't stop. You just want to keep talking, you know?
Yeah.
All right. Do y'all need this?
Do I got to turn this on?
No.
I'll leave it on.
Hey, whenever you're done, call
Xander.
Okay.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
This morning, the Mayfield sisters are going to sing Sunday Sermons by Ann Wilson, and feel free to sing along.
Something changing me. Red letters coming off the page, flooding my heart with amazing grace. I knew then, I believed, and those roots run deep. Oh, I've been through some phase, shaking hard times, yeah. but nothing's gonna make me forget. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a hard service, hearing through those Sunday sermons.
Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
Gonna have my worries, but that's part of life. When I think of those stories, that what my God can do. He's still moving like He did back then. Born again, people, can I get an amen? You've all seen the proof. He makes all things new. Even all those face shaking hard times, yeah. I never want to stop remembering. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a heart stirring, spirit moving Sunday sermon.
Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
Oh, one of those Sunday sermons. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, ain't no doubt, so I'm gonna keep on talking about. Oh yeah, every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know we'll make it through, all because of those hard sermons, peering through the Sunday sermons.
Take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
He's going to pray over our offering today.
Thank you for our offering. Jesus, Lord, amen.
Down a rocky road to teach my feet to stand. Then you led me through the valley low so that I would hold your hand. Then on the raging sea of time, you taught my eyes to see. Like a flower, the rain helps me to grow, and you make it rain for me.
Mm-hmm.
been walking many, many miles, and you have never failed. Through flame and floods, I've walked with you, and through the stormy gales, no matter where your steps may go, wherever they may lead, out in the desert, so hot and dry, I know you'll make it rain for me. You form the clouds with your own hands to hide the light of day, so that I would learn to trust in you all along the way. Lord, I won't question these tears that I've cried while down on bended knees. For when my soul, it gets thirsty,
blessing me, all the things you've done. So I want us to go to the Lord with thanksgiving in our heart as we remember these needs before Him today. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your deliverance. Father God, we thank you for healing these that we brought before you today. We thank you for healing these that are in church today, Lord God. We thank you for making a way that where there is no way, Lord God. We know that you're able to do above and beyond what we can ask. And Father God, we believe in it. We give you glory and honor for it. We go ahead and thank you, Lord God, for moving in these behalf. Father God, these that are sick, these that are hurting, these that are in the hospital, Lord God, these that have cancer, I lift them up to you today, Lord God. I pray that you would deliver them. I pray that you would heal their body. You would set their feet in the right motion, Lord God. And you would fill their heart with the Holy Spirit. Father God, these that are struggling financially, Lord God, these that are struggling emotionally, Lord God, I pray that your hand of protection and mercy and your hand of comfort would be upon them, Lord God. You would give them the answer, Lord God, that they're seeking only through you. Father God, these that are just need a special touch from you, I pray that you'll be closer than a brother, that you'll reach out and lay your hand upon them, Lord God, and lift them up. Father God, I pray that this congregation today, Lord God, I know that there's a lot of struggling, Lord God. There's a lot going on in our lives, Lord God. I pray that you would give us all peace. Father God, you would give us direction. You would give us comfort, Lord God. Father God, anoint us with the Holy Spirit. Father God, that we may be led and directed in the path of righteousness. Father, I ask all things in your name today. Pray and believe. Amen.
With my heart filled with my
Let's lift our hands and give God praise. Lift our hands and our voices to Him this morning. Would you do so? Our Father in heaven, thank you for your faith. Psalms chapter 34, verse number 8. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in Him. O fear the Lord, ye His saints, for there is no want or lack to them that fear Him. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want or shall not lack for any good thing. O taste and see that the Lord is good. How many of you know that you can have an appetite for God? I want to pick up this morning and continue on the subject of having an appetite for God. Having an appetite for God. Father, this morning we thank you. Thank you that we can hunger and thirst after you, and that you will feel that hunger and that thirst. As we've gathered in this house today, we have sensed your presence through every phase of this worship service. Thank you for what you are doing in our lives. But Father, for the next few moments, I ask for the help of the Holy Spirit that I might be able to preach what you've laid on my heart. If there's ever an hour that we need to have a hunger and a thirst for you, it is in this hour when so many other things are appealing to our hearts. Give me audience with this congregation. I pray for the anointing to preach in a manner that everybody here will understand. And we will thank you for this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, having an appetite for God. The word appetite means to have a craving for something, to have a craving, a desire. We understand that from the scripture that not only do we have physical appetites, but you can also have a spiritual appetite. The Bible teaches us that we are to have a spiritual appetite for the things of God. Psalms chapter 34, verse 8 says, O taste and see that the Lord is good. How many of you know that experience? O taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalms chapter number 42, verses 1 and 2 says, as the deer pants after the water brooks, so pants my soul after thee, O God. Psalms chapter 63, verse 1 says, O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longs for thee as in a dry and a thirsty land where no water is. Psalms 107 and verse 9 says that God satisfies the longing soul, and the hungry soul he fills with goodness. Think about that. There is that spiritual hole in our lives that God can satisfy. He satisfies the longing soul, the soul that will long after him. And to those that hunger for him, he fills with goodness. Amen. Psalms 143 and verse number 6 says, I stretch my hands unto thee, for my soul is thirsty for thee. You see, the stretching of the hands means, God, I realize you're here and I recognize you, but I need something from you and I stretch my hands to you. That's why we lift our hands in the house of God, is that we recognize God's presence is here. We lift our hands because we want to approach him as a little child would their parent or a family member they love and feel comfortable with. They'll lift their hands and we lift our hands and we say, oh God, my soul is thirsty. Jesus said it in Matthew 5 and 6, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. John chapter 4 and verse 14, Jesus said to the woman at the well, if you knew the gift of God and who it was that was speaking with you, talking with you and asked you for water, if you knew who it was, who I was, you would ask of me to give you living water.
John chapter number 6 and verse 35, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He that comes unto me will never hunger. He that believes on me will never thirst. You see, this is why Jesus is not a religion, he's a relationship. Because religion cannot satisfy hunger, only a relationship can. John chapter 7, verse 37 and 38, the scripture says it was the last day, it was the last day, the great day of the feast, that Jesus stood and cried, if any man is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. For if he believes upon me, as the scripture have said, out of his innermost beings will flow rivers of living waters. For this he spake of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Understand this, friend, you and I are spiritual beings living in a human body. You have a spiritual appetite. We need to pause and look at what we are feeding our spirit upon. You see, not only can you feed upon the things of God, but you can feed upon the things of sin. Book of Philippians chapter number 3, verses 18 and 19, Paul writes, he says that there are those who walk, as I have told you often, and I tell you now, even weeping, they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is their shame, and who mind earthly things. Notice what Paul said. He said, whose God is their belly. In other words, their appetites has become their God. What you hunger and what you thirst after, you will bow the knee to. What you hunger, what you thirst after. If you don't thirst after the right thing, let me say something to you. If you can't get good bread, moldy bread to satisfy. If you can't drink from living water, you'll drink from a cesspool. You're going to satisfy that hunger and that thirst some way. Follow me. You see, every one of us in this room need to understand the importance that there is a significance about what you have an appetite for. David writes about it in Psalms 34, verses 8 through 10. He said in verse number 8, he said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How many of you know God's good? That word taste means to have an experience. I've had an experience with him, and the results is God's good. He says, blessed is the man that trusts him. I preached on this last week where that if you have a hunger to trust God, there's an appetite to trust God. You can have an appetite that you want to trust him. Amen? But today I want to look at verse number 9 where he says, oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no lack to them that fear him. I want to unpack that little verse just a moment. As it continues in the frame, the context of having an appetite for God. Verse 9 follows verse number 8 where he said, oh, taste, experience, have a taste, have an appetite for God. Because you'll like what you experience, he's good. That appetite will move you to trust him. But I also want to assure you that appetite will also involve a transformation. That's what verse 9 is talking about. You see, if you got an appetite for God, that appetite for God will bring about a transformation in your life. Not only if you have an appetite will you trust God, but if you have an appetite for God, it'll also bring about a transformation. So let me unpack it. Let me unpack it real quick. Excuse me. Follow along with me. Notice what he says, oh, fear the Lord. What does it mean to fear God? What you talking about when he said, fear the Lord? A lot of people mistake fear as being filled with anxiety, being filled with panic or terror. They feel they have to be anxious in the presence of God. They have to panic at the presence of God. They have to be in terror of the presence of God. We understand fear causes torment. The fear of God will never cause you to have torment unless you're not right with Him. Amen. You see, the fear of God involves three aspects. Number one, to fear God means that you reverence Him. You reverence Him. You have a love and a respect for Him. Follow me. You have a love and a respect for Him. How many of you know that that's critical in this hour when man is elevating so many ideas and thoughts that if you fear God, don't tell me you fear God, but yet you don't reverence Him. If you reverence God, you'll have a love, you'll have a respect for Him. Amen? Second of all, it means that you recognize His presence. You see, people that don't fear God, they don't recognize God's presence is with them on a daily basis. No matter where I go, God's presence is with me. The scripture teaches that in Psalms 139. He said, if I flee to the mountains, you're there. If I make my bed in hell or in the depths of the earth, you're there. No matter where I go, God's presence is with me. If you have the fear of God, you not only reverence and love Him and have an awe and an admiration for Him, but you recognize His presence is with you. No matter whether you physically feel it, you know His presence is there. Not only do you recognize that presence, but you have a regard for His will. If you live in the fear of God, you reverence Him. You recognize His presence and you have a regard for His will. In other words, it's not third, fourth, fifth, sixth down on the list. It's first and foremost. What is God's will about this matter which I'm fixing to do? What is God's will about this before I make this purchase, before I get involved in this relationship, before I do this? What is it that God's will would be in this? You see, when people live in the fear of God, they'll reverence God. They'll recognize His presence and they'll always live with a regard for what is God's will in this. You see, to live in the fear of God means that you live in obedient submission. Let me say that again. To live in the fear of God means to live in obedient submission. Some people live in submission out of terror. Some people live in submission to God out of panic. Some people live in submission to God because they don't want to go to hell. That's a miserable life to live. I live in submission because I don't want to go to hell. That's not living in the fear of God. I live in the fear of God because I reverence Him. I recognize His precious and sweet presence. And I have a regard for His will because I believe as for God, His way is perfect. You submit in obedience. You don't kick against it. You don't fight against it. But you submit in obedience and say, Lord, I want to do Your will. Amen? So that's what the fear of God is. A lot of people, they make the fear of God something that it's not. And I hope that this will help you to understand. Living in the fear of God, when you recognize His presence, there's a lot of people that disrespect God, disrespect the name of God. But you know, we should not hide our reverence for God in public. We got people that are living for the devil and they don't hide it. We got people that are living for the devil, living for sin, and they're not ashamed of their lifestyle. Why should we be ashamed of reverencing God in public? I don't think we should have a problem praying in the restaurant, calling on the name of the Lord. I believe we recognize His presence. God is present. He's here with me. I'm not walking this thing alone. We got to understand that. He said He would not leave me as orphans, but He'd send the Holy Spirit to walk with me. God's presence is here. And then I want God's will because I believe God is concerned about my life. Therefore, I want to consider His will. What does God have to say about this? You see, that's important. So that's what the fear of God involves, entails, and that's what it means. Second of all, I want to ask the question I want to deal with is where David said, O fear the Lord, ye His saints. I want to look at that word saint. What does it mean to be a saint? Turn to the one next to you and look at him and say, hey, saint.
Hey,
What does it mean to be a saint? The word saint in the Hebrew text there, and you know the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, the New Testament was written in Greek, so in the Old Testament, the word saint means to be set apart for service unto God. The word saint means to be set apart as service to God. In the New Testament Greek, the word saint means to be dedicated and separated unto service unto God. So that means the same. So understand, to be a saint does not mean that you are a member of some hierarchy. To be a saint does not mean you've had a title conferred upon you by some order of the church. To be a saint means this: you have been born again of the Spirit of God. That's what the word saint means, is that you have been born again of the Spirit of God, meaning you have been set apart to do service unto God. Now follow me very closely so you'll understand why everybody who accepts Jesus as their Savior is a saint. Well, most of us in this room have a problem to say that we're saint, because we, in our concept, saint is somebody who's perfect. Well, let me let the pressure off. I'm not perfect, and I know you ain't. I'm not perfect, and I know you ain't. Okay? The pressure's off. We all in this room are broken, bandaged, beat up, messed up people. We are saints with dysfunctions. Where the concept come that to be a saint means that you're perfect has messed a lot of people up. It's messed a lot of people up. To be a saint, means that you are separated unto the service of God, to live for God. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in verse 2. Says, unto the church of God at Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus the Lord, who are called to be saints, with all everywhere who is called upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Did you get that? He said to the Corinthian church, they was a messed up Pentecostal people. They had lust in that church. They was greed in that church. They were suing one another. I mean, they was a mess. That church, you could tell they were from Jackson County. And before some of you say, oh, a little bit of Gadsden, Calhoun, and Washington was also in there, okay? Paul said to the church of God at Corinth, who are sanctified in Christ Jesus our Lord, who are called to be saints, who are called to be separated unto God, with all, in all place, in every place, who've called upon the name of the Lord. So this is what it is. If you've called upon the name of the Lord as your Savior, you're a saint. That's what the scripture teaches. If you've called upon the name of the Lord, you are a saint. In other words, you have been separated unto God for service. So turn to the one next to you and look at them and say, hello, saint. I saw some of you wives raise an eyebrow. To be a saint is not based upon the estimate of someone else. It's based upon what God says. To be a saint means that you've called upon the name of Jesus and you have been separated from sin unto a service to God. It all takes place when you call on the name of the Lord. Now follow me. Now stay with me. I hope by the time we're through today, that maybe I've been able to encourage you in your walk with the Lord. So That's what we're talking about to be a saint. I want you to follow me now here. First of all, number one, to be a saint means you have chosen to hunger after God. We're still talking about having an appetite because that's what he said. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is a man that trusts in him. He says, oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints. Fear the Lord, ye his saints. Because you hunger for him, there should be a fear there as a saint being separated unto God. So first of all, to be a saint means you choose to hunger after God. Joshua 24:15, Joshua said to the elders of Israel, said, if it be seem evil to you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you're going to serve. You're going to serve the gods that our father served on the other side of the flood? Are you going to serve the gods of the Amorites in the land which you dwell? But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You see, you choose to hunger after God. Can't nobody make you hunger after God. You choose. What appetite do you want to have in your life? What kind of appetite do you want to have? And if you want to hunger for God, you can hunger for God. You say, well, I don't understand the word of God. I don't understand everything about the Spirit of God. I just don't understand. Listen, you don't have to understand anything to have a hunger for God. It's not based on what you know, what you understand. That will come. The hunger comes when you say, I want God to fill the emptiness and the void in my life. I want to have a hunger and a thirst for that which will last. Amen. Amen. So if you're a saint, you choose to hunger after God. Second of all, if you're a saint, you will commit to nurturing a hunger for God. If you've been separated in the service to God, you will commit to nourishing that hunger for God. Matthew 5:6, Jesus said, blessed, happy, blessed, truly happy are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Deuteronomy 8:3 says that man will not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. You see, you've got to nurture that appetite. Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 16 says, I found thy word and I ate it. And it was the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Listen to that. He said, I found thy word and I ate it. And your word was the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. You see, if you don't expose yourself to the word of God, you won't nurture that appetite for God. 1 Timothy 4:6 tells us you can be nourished by the word of faith. You can be nourished by the word of faith. You see, you can be going through a situation in life and your spirit gets depleted just as much or more so than the physical depletion. You can go and go and go and do and do and do till you get physically tired. You know what? Your spirit gets the same way. Your spirit gets the same way. And you know, when you're hungry, you have to feed that natural hunger, right? I know some of you are saying, well, great heavens, brother, you know, you must be hungry all the time. You have spoken the truth. But there is just as much a spiritual hunger as there is a physical hunger. And if you do not nurture that spiritual hunger, you're going to feed on something else. You're going to feed your spirit something. Listen to me now. You're going to feed that longing. Everybody in this room, everybody watching my live stream, you've got a longing in your soul. And you're either going to have an appetite for God or you're going to have an appetite of something to satisfy that longing that's in your heart. Why? God intended for us to have an appetite for him. You see, you nourish that soul by feeding upon the things of God, by feeding upon the things. So you choose the word of God. You choose to hunger after God. You must commit to nurturing. that appetite. You get in the Word. You get in the Word. You say, the Word is boring to me. No, it's not. It's not. I mean, you get in the Word. You know, listen, if you've just got saved, listen to me as a pastor. Do not start reading the book of Leviticus. You need to start reading the Gospel of John. And then read Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And then read the book of Acts. And then read the book of Ephesians. Read the epistles. Devour them. Devour them. There's no reason why you and I today, there's many of good versions out there that have taken and put it in our vernacular. The King James Version, I was raised on it, and I commit it to memory. I don't speak in the thees and thous. I don't look at Sister Amy and say, I love us thee. She'd look at me and say, huh? No, I say, I love you. And this is her famous word, I love you bunches. That's not King James Version. That's Amy Version. But there's a lot of versions out there that can help you understand the Word of God. And I know some of you think, oh my God, he's committing sacrilege and blasphemy and all that. No, 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 no. The King James Version is not the original. I'll let some of you think about that, okay? Understand you can get in the Word of God and listen to the Word of God. Let it feed your spirit. Get in the Word of God. Let it feed your spirit. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, "Hello, saint." I know some of you are saying, "I don't want to lie." You're not lying. So you choose to be hungry, you commit and you nurture that, but here's something I want you to notice, that as a saint, your character is transformed by your hunger for God. As a saint, your character is transformed by your hunger for God. You see, that's why if you have a hunger for God, you can't stay the same that you was when you accepted him. There's something going to happen in your life. You see, the very word saint denotes a change. You were not born a saint. You were born with sinful tendencies. We have to learn to do good, right? We are by nature the children of wrath. We were not born a saint, but you can be born again and be a saint. Everybody follow me. So when you're born again, that word saint denotes that there has been a change. You've been set to be a saint means you have been set apart. You're taken out of the kingdom of darkness and put in the kingdom of light. You're set free from the bondages of sin and you become a servant unto Jesus Christ. There's a change. You go from being a sinner to being a saint. So don't let saint is not being perfect. It means you set apart for service. Now, Philippians chapter 2 verse 12 and 13 says this, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. You see, every one of us, when we get saved the same way by faith in Jesus Christ. Every one of us get saved by putting our faith in Jesus Christ, Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for by grace are you saved through faith and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. But when we get saved, every one of us, come into the kingdom of God with stuff that held on, that we developed when we were living in the kingdom of darkness. And so when you come into the kingdom of God and you are a saint, you are now set apart into service to God, and you start living for God, you begin to realize there's some things in my heart that whenever I'm confronted with choices and decisions that before I became a saint, this is how I handled it. But now that I'm a saint, I can't handle it the way I used to. So now I got to work out my salvation with fear and trembling. You see, some people, everybody in this room has different challenges. Not everybody has the same challenges that we have to work through in our walk with God. Some people in this room, you have an issue with lust. Some people in this room, you have an issue with greed. Some people in this room, you have an issue with anger. Some people in this room, you have an issue with unforgiveness. Some of you think you ain't got no issue, but you do. That within itself says something. So we come to the Lord, we put our faith in Jesus, we trust God, and we start, we're excited, we're thrilled, we get in the Word of God, we're praying. Even when you get filled with the Spirit of God, man, there's just a power and there's enthusiasm, there's an anointing, and you get to going down this life's journey, and then all of a sudden, boom. You got to understand, a lot of people think that transformation is an event. It's not. Transformation is a journey. It starts somewhere. It's got to start somewhere. It's not an event. It's a journey. And you know what? You're going to keep on transforming until you leave this planet. Amen. So you got to, there's some things you have to work out. I mean, before you got saved, you handle things in your way, your strength, your ability. Now that you're saved, the your old fleshly nature says, you know, if they wronged you, just cuss them out. Now that you're saved, you can't cuss them out anymore. Not that you didn't want to. Come on now. Not that you don't want to. Just because you want to and you do is two different things. Trying to help some of you out here. You thought you got saved and committed to the Lord, you'd never be tempted with lust or greed or things of that nature, but you are. Doesn't mean you're lost. It means you're saved. Because the devil don't like it when he loses you. So you have to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. God's working in you. You work it out while he works in you. Amen? Turn to your saint next to you and say, he's preaching good. So you got to work it out. They're just things that you have to work out. Some were raised in circumstances in their home life that wasn't good. So you learn to cope with things that wasn't good, that wasn't pleasant. And now you're saved. You can't cope. You can't go to those old coping mechanisms. You follow me? So now you got to work out your salvation. So let me give this to you. I got to hurry. Man, time is running out on me this morning. Psalms 119, verse 59 and 60 says, I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. These two verses has a lot to do with transformation. I want you to follow me. When you come to Jesus Christ and you get saved, you become a saint separated under service to God. There's two things you're going to have to do your whole journey of transformation. Number one, you're going to have to live with intention. Psalms 119, verse 59 says, I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. You're going to have to constantly be intentional about the direction your feet are walking. You can't live by chance. You've got to stop and think about the direction you're going. Because see, you can let things in your heart and your life that if you don't deal with before long, it'll become callous and it'll just become part of you and you don't even realize it. Right. You know what? You can work around a hog farm and you'll get to smelling that stink to where before long it won't bother you. But everywhere you go, everybody smells stink. I know I used to work on a hog farm. You have to wear that mess off. You can't wash it off. I'd come home, Mama would say, whoo, son, you stink. What do you mean, Mama? She said, you stink. Working out hog farm. You see, you can, if you're not careful about what you got going on in your life, if it's not of God, before long, it'll just get normal to you. That's why you got to stop and think about it a little bit. Am I behaving right? Am I making right choices? Do I have the right attitude here? Am I doing what I should be doing? And if you're not, you got to be intentional. He said, I fought on my ways and I turned my feet unto your testimonies. So in other words, every day, every week, every month, you need to stop making inspection of your life. Is my life being transformed? Because if you're not growing, you should be growing in some aspect of your walk with God. And that growing, you got to be intentional. You must be intentional. About to follow me this morning. Not only must you be intentional, but verse number 60 says this, I made haste and delayed not to keep your commandments. Not only do you have to be intentional, you got to have determination. You got to have determination. When you know that you've got something in your life that ought not to be there, don't put it off. Deal with it. Deal with it. You're not responsible for other people's behavior. You're responsible for your own. You can't control other people. You can't control the world. You can only control you. You and I can only control our response. So when the Holy Spirit begins to deal with our heart, don't say, well, Lord, what about them? What about them? Why don't you deal with them? Who's to say he's not dealing with them? But we have to stop and look at our life. And he said, I made haste and delayed not to keep your commandments. So there's got to be determination. You got to be intentional and you got to be determined. And remember this, that what you feed on is really what you become. Jeremiah said, in Jeremiah 15, 16, I found your word and I ate your word and your word was a joy and rejoicing in my heart. If you feed on bitterness, resentment, lust, greed, malice, indifference, carelessness, unconcern, hate, have I found your sin yet? Gossip. You feed on that, that's what you're going to become. Turn to your neighbor and say, saint. Boy, he's preaching to you this morning. You see, what you feed on, what you feed, what you have an appetite for, that's what you become. But you got to be intentional and you got to be determined. Amen. Okay, here's my last thought for those of you that are stressed out over this message. You got to choose to hunger for God. You got to commit to nurturing that hunger. Your character will be transformed by your hunger. Here's the fourth thing I want you to notice about this. As a saint, your connection to God is promised. God will meet all your needs. There's a benefit in being a saint. Psalms 34 verse 8 says, O fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no lack to them who fear him. In other words, to those who fear him, all their needs will be met. Didn't say wants now, but your needs. God will supply all your needs. God will make a way. Amen? I'm telling you, God will make a way if you have an appetite for him. I always said this, I believe it. You know, we kind of put God in a box and think God has to do it this way for it to come about. God can do anything he wants the way he wants to do it. I've often said, if the Lord knew my need was to have fried chicken, he'd send a rooster to my back doorstep, smite it with a heart attack, and I could have some chicken. God will take care of your needs, right? You hunger for God, you hunger for God, you're living for God, you're going to face challenges, you're going to face difficulties, you're going to face circumstances that aren't easy, you're going to walk through some difficult valleys, you're going to go through some wide curves of life. Sometimes you're going to think, I don't know when the end of this circumstance is ever going to be. I just wonder, why in the world, what's going on here? Your mind's perplexed, you just can't make sense of the whole situation. That doesn't mean God's forsaken you. Come on now. I still fear God because I believe he's with me. I believe that the Lord is with me and I know God is going to provide. Why? Because I am his child. I'm serving him. I have a hunger for him. And David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging for bread. God will make a way for you, friend. You listen to me. God will make a way for you. It'll come in a way you didn't imagine.
That's right.
It'll come through somebody you never thought of. God wants to bless you. Don't worry about who he sends it through. Amen? You heard the story about the woman that praised God for everything. She was always thanking God, rejoicing in the Lord, just praising God. And her neighbor was an atheist. And her neighbor was always just constantly berating her and telling her God wasn't nothing to her religion or anything. And so he found out that she didn't have groceries. So he went to the store and bought her a bunch of groceries, put it on the doorstep. And was standing over in the bushes when she come out and found the groceries. She said, oh, goodness. She said, oh, Lord, thank you for these groceries. Thank you for providing them. And he jumped out from behind the bush and said, hey, wait just a minute. God didn't give you them groceries. I did. She stopped and says, thank you, Lord. You can even use the devil sometimes to bless me. Woo! Listen, don't box God in. Let him have his way. He's God. Come on. Fear the Lord, all ye his saints. For those who fear him, they'll never lack. You may not have what other people have, but God will make sure your needs are met. God will make sure your needs are met. He has a way of doing it. I don't know how he does it. He won't only take care of your material needs, but he'll take care of your physical needs. He'll take care of everything that you need. He'll take care of your spiritual needs. And if your appetite's not on the Lord this morning, this is a good morning. This is a good morning to say, Lord, give me an appetite for you. Give me an appetite for you. And if you'll have an appetite for him, and you feed on the things of God, you'll begin to be transformed. I'm going to say this, and Sister Vanessa, if you'll go ahead and prepare to sing. There's some of you probably sitting under the sound of my voice, you think you can never be changed. You're sitting here, you're thinking, well, God will never do nothing in my life. I've lived this way a long time. I've always had these issues in my life. It'll never be changed. My daddy, my granddaddy, my great-granddaddy, my great-great-granddaddy, my great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-granddaddy, all the way back, they all had these horrible issues of their life, and it's just meant to be. That's the way I'm always going to be. I want to say something to you. That's a lie. Because it's what you have an appetite for. If you have an appetite for God and you'll follow through on that appetite for God, God will change you. God will change you. God will change you. Father of heaven, thank you this morning for the word of God.